Now, everything is clear. The magnitude of the problem is more than what we expect. We need to work with adolescents. We need to work with their parents too. And we need to do all these soon, before it is too late. Because our job is to defuse the bomb before it explodes. We belong to the disaster aversion team, not the disaster management team. So our mission would be to screen adolescents for physical and mental health, and to help them if required, to empower them with as many stress busters as possible, and to teach parents the art of parenting. In this process, there are some obstacles which are likely to be encountered. Number one is the adolescent ego, and number two is awareness. To tackle the adolescent ego, we can approach them with confidence, with good body language, with sufficient time, enough to build a good rapport with them, respect their ego, respect their privacy and confidentiality, be friendly with them, be genuinely interested in their problems, try to handle them in groups, and use a solution-based approach rather than talking about problems repeatedly, and motivate them in such a way that they change from within. The problem of awareness, although we know that most of the children and adolescents have one or more of the problems that we have listed, the major problem is awareness. Parents need to know that their adolescents have a problem. They need to come forward for help. They need to know that help is available. So far, only problems that present loudly, like infections, injuries, and vision problems, are brought to our notice. Others are being tolerated or ignored. We are also trying to address the problem of awareness by talking to adults in different forums, group discussions, seminars, and lectures. We are also working with children and adolescents through schools and colleges in groups. In this forum, I appeal to all the pediatricians and physicians to kindly take some time and do at least a brief screening, at least once a year, and pick up problems which they don't come with and offer solutions which they don't seek. That gives immense pleasure, and that's very rewarding too. Together, let us show them the gateway for complete well-being. Let us enable them to do better than their best. They deserve all this, because they are our nation's future and wealth. Thank you.
I felt like I was in a spiritual discourse for some time.
It's a very high, powerful
experience. I have two personal observations, one positive, one negative. The positive observation is my own personal observation. Any parent has got a children within 3-2 years, instead of leaving a gap of 6 years, 7 years, they do better. Because we can never become a 100% role model for our children. Whereas if you have got, unfortunately what happens is, we marry a bit late, then get the first child, then postpone second child for 6 years, 7 years. But then the gap between the two children also grow. Therefore I found the families in which the children are brought within 3-4 years. They do well. Of course, if you want to stop with one child, that's a different issue. If you want to have two issues. The second is a negative approach. This was told to me by many people, and I also feel it. Culturally, we thought if you do some sin, you will get a bad reward. Then came the concept of power manipu. Power manipu was a concept for a self-purification, where if you do a mistake, you go to a designated person, tell you have made a mistake, and then he corrects you, and then half of them get corrected, half of them don't correct. Then came the concept of jihad. Jihad is a concept you say, the other fellow is bad, therefore he has to be killed. Go and kill him, you will go to the moksha. Then came the television. The television at least is better. Whatever crime is shown is seen as the family. So that one fellow tells other fellow, oh, this is good, this is bad, discussion is there. Then came the internet. Internet, you are nobody, that is, you are alone. You see whatever you want. Now in this technological era, how are you going to be a role model? How are you going to change? This is a negative approach.
Thank you. That is a role model, sir. Foods is all wonderful. Can you define the age group of adolescent pediatrics?
Adolescents generally, it is taken as 10 to 19 years.
Yes.
But even up to 21 years, we
yes, according to
this is according to the American Academy of Pediatrics. And since 1994 or 1995 onwards, it is a separate board certified specialty in America.
How do you relate the goiter problem with adolescents?
No, around that age we expect that. Generally they don't come with problems, but it will, I mean, we need to observe that. And we need to tell them that it doesn't require treatment mostly. More of a prevention kind of approach. When they really come with problems in adolescence, it becomes difficult.
Adolescents are anemic. The both of male and female?
Yes, universally, both. Because it's a period of rapid growth spurt. So the requirements are more. But then this is the age when they don't eat properly. I mean, they kind of take all the junk foods. And almost all of them are anemic. Whether it is the hemoglobin level, but if you do the ferritin level, most of them are subclinical. And it works on their attention, concentration, memory, mood, everything. So when they come with all these problems, you look into the ferritin levels, it is immediately low.
Symptoms, can you, how to find out that this boy has got adolescent disease? Symptoms, by way of talk or bad words, how you take this? How you measure it? How the parent can, as a view, how they can view it?
When they come with any particular problem, we do a problem-oriented approach. We try to solve that problem. When they generally walk in for a well adolescent visit, we do a complete screening, whatever are the physical problems related to this age group. And mental well-being also, we have a proper systematic questionnaires and assessment. Based on that, we tell whether this particular adolescent is mentally healthy or not. Mainly the problem is there's one thing called temperament, which is from birth to up to 5 years. It is moldable, it is changeable. They are called wet clays. But after the age of 5 years, what happens, all the problems, the temperamental problems that they have, almost becomes difficult to change. Still, they are called drying clays. With effort, we can do something. But after 13 to 14 years, they are resistant to change. So that becomes their personality. So the best thing would be to pick it up early, to at least have a general well child or a well adolescent visit and help them at the earliest. Later on, it becomes a permanent problem. Those are the people who go in for psychiatric problems.
Next and last topic is the other.